Hello boys and girls. In this video we are going to shine a light on the Euler formula, the standard one for real or complex numbers, and then also higher dimensional variations and generalizations. We are going to discuss a super general variant of it where you nevertheless still see the Euler formula in it. But also then somewhere in the middle is the three-dimensional case where we have the Rodrigues formula, which gives a very efficient way and a surprisingly small expression of how to compute the a rotation matrix from the angle axis that defines it. So okay, of course, so this is the Euler formula, right? The exponential function of ix, or e to the power of ix, equals the cosine of x plus I times the sine of x. Just to quickly jump to what we are going to see. So for example, there is the so-called Rodrigues formula, which says that a rotation matrix, and you know, any like Lie group element, and the rotation matrices SO3 are Lie group elements, can be represented, as you know, we've discussed a bunch of times in this channel already, in terms of the generator in the Lie algebra. So any element therefore is an exp of something, the exponential function, in this case matrix exponential of some other matrix. So this R is really exp of something, and as you can see here, the claim is that this is the identity matrix time, and then you also have the sine and cosines here, and then there is this K object. So if you scroll up here a little bit, a K is really a generic skew symmetric matrix in three dimension, and as we're going to see, this skew symmetric matrices, they generalize the imaginary unit. And so just for a quick heuristic to get from this three-dimensional case to the normal Euler formula, if k squares to minus 1 as the imaginary unit does, for example, right, then this 1 and this 1 will cancel, and you have here a plus cosine, and so you get back to the formula. We were going to make this super explicit, what how they relate to each other, but we're also not really just... like the three dimensions are a focus, of course, because we're interested in the physics of rotations and so on. But we'll have a much more algebraic and more broader perspective on how formulas like the Euler formula pop up, and in which cases they reduce to this formula or the normal Euler formula. So quickly, it relates. Like, you know, I did this video on the quaternion algebras, at least their representations, and over a general field, and, you know, with a bunch of parameters. And they're already also, if you could recall that, if you have seen it, an Euler formula, a special case of what we are going to discuss today, also popped up in that video. I did a follow-up video on the Lie algebras here, and of course, a few days ago I talked about the exponential and their relations, the Kipper-Campbell-Hausdorff formula, and in particular also I dedicated a video on the axis angle representations of rotations. So there's going to be an overlap with all of those, especially the one from 1 week ago, this one. Okay, so to have here a quick look what we're going to get out, these are some of the formulas that we are going to get. I will say in a second then what, or by a second I mean in half an hour, what the J is really here. But this is basically one of the nicest versions of the Euler formula, one of the general nicest versions that a lot of these cases that we have seen with the quaternions, with the rotation matrix, with the normal complex numbers are special cases of. Later at the end of the video, I'm then coming back also to the rotations. And before I even get to that, we have a much more general view on what is the Euler formula really, right? Because it is a relation between some function, for example, the exponential function, and then how it is partitioned in this case in direct sine and cosine, and we're going to get a broader perspective on this sort of formula. But okay, before we get there, nevertheless, I will not jump into the abstract algebra right away. I say abstract algebra, but it's going to be very like hands-on, like symbolic manipulations and computations, really. But nevertheless, let me recall the one-dimensional case first, then motivate the three-dimensional case, and then go to the generality. Okay. So okay, I define some set, and T is going to be complex numbers, and I write down a bunch of the standard series expansions. Right. The most important ones are the the question is how to pronounce it in English. Hyperbolic cosine. I'm going to go with that. The hyperbolic cosine, and how it looks like. You know, this is this infinite sum over the even powers of the complex number divided by 2k factorial, and hyperbolic sine similarly, but it's basically the same thing except the index shifted by one. And then the exponential function has all these coefficients, and really the exponential function already like separates into these two parts, right? All the even terms in the exponential series put together are just the hyperbolic cosine, and the uneven ones are the hyperbolic sine. So this is really I guess usually in the you know first semester the proof of the Euler formula goes something like that. You just look at the series and then you say, oh whoa, there's the complex unit squares to minus one per definition, and so you make some identifications and then you have the formulas. That's basically the proof. And this is also kind of evident here. So the cosine, of course, is the same series expansion, except it has this minus sign on every second, like the alternating minus sign between those. And here you just you just need to plug in an iz in here, and then you will get this minus sign out of it, and then it's already proven, right? So these are all like these relations are all consequences of just I squaring to minus one, and then you are there. Oops, and I forgot an I here. Let me quickly open that. Yeah, so. Okay. Yeah. Actually, just as a side note, I kind of like to have this kind of minimal approach where I define the hyperbolic cosine and sine, and then really just define all the other functions in terms of that. So, to say, you know, the exponential function is really the sum of them by definition, and also kind of take sine and cosine is kind of derived from that, like taking this as a definition, but this is just a side note of like a purity thing. Okay, and I want to emphasize that it will become relevant when we compare it to the other algebraic cases, that in this power series expansion, the convention is always that any complex number to the power of zero is taken as one, and so this works out. I mean, you know, you can take any convention you want, but then you just have if you have more complicated convention, then you just have complicated terms. The math is still the same because these are just conventions, but then you don't have the nice functions. But that's what we're going to also adopt here initially for the imaginary unit. And a lot of what we're going to do now is basically taking this relation here, like I squared is minus one, and we are going to abstract from that. We're going to generalize that and see where it leads us. And we're going to see, even if we don't assume this relation, but maybe a weaker relation, then this the nice simplification of series expansions to something like Euler formulas pops up, and this is what this is about. Okay, so going on, the first thing that I'm doing is I'm going to get from now from this you might say complex one-dimensional case to the a two and three-dimensional case. The two-dimensional case that here I'm going to talk about is really also just the one-dimensional complex case, right? The complex numbers are over the reals two-dimensional vector space, so this thing pops up immediately here as well. So let's just discuss it nevertheless quickly in detail. So the real 2x2 matrix representations of the complex numbers are as such. So we map any complex number where A and B are real numbers. This is complex number to this 2x2 matrix, where we have this real number multiplied by a 2x2 matrix. This is going to be the unit matrix. We have it here. And B also, I also a 2x2 matrix, but it looks like that. You know, this is what we discussed in this video, that this I matrix is really a rotation by 90 degrees. And this, the vector space spanned by these two matrices, you know, if you take these two matrices as basis elements, is a representation actually then of the complex numbers, because I mean these two matrices, they are matrices, but they commute because one of them is the identity matrix, and the identity matrix commutes with itself and anything else. And indeed, you know, you can check that if you take this I2 and square it, just do a simple matrix multiplication, you get minus I0 minus I, and this is exactly minus times the identity. And so now we have this two-dimensional case, but it's really just the same as the complex one-dimensional case. And I also, like, where we are going with this, E, the two-dimensional identity matrix is really also just the other matrix, I to the power of 0 by convention here. Okay, we're going to write it here. And so what follows is then that I to the power of, like, I2 to the power of 2 is minus I2 to the power of 0. So there is a reduction of the power, but we get a minus sign, right? This I, obviously, I call it I because it acts like a complex unit. So we have this formula for all natural numbers d from 0 to infinity. I to the power of d plus 2, we can cancel the one of the, like, two of the powers, and we get the minus sign instead of it. So for example, I2 to the power of 7 is the same as minus I to the power of 5, because we can just take two of them and get a minus instead. And here a note that, you know, if you go up, now if I to the power, I will say I, not I2, okay? If you take I to the power of 4, then this is just I to the power of 2 squared, right? So you see that I to the power of 4 is just the identity matrix again, and then I to the power of 6 is again minus the identity matrix, and so on and so forth. So this flips sign every second power, and also it flips the type of matrix, like, for every power. Every, like, for example, every even power of I is proportional to the identity matrix. So the identity matrix is a symmetric matrix. So every even power of I is a symmetric matrix, whereas every odd power of I is proportional to I and thus an anti-symmetric matrix, right? So it oscillates between anti-symmetric and symmetric and every power, every step of the next power that you do, and between positive and negative every two steps. Okay, this is just a note to as we're going to abstract from that away, we're going to take care and track what for properties are we going to keep and what consequences just these properties have. That's the point of this. Okay, so we can trivially also extend this to a three-dimensional case, although this will be a little bit different. So what we do here is we just add an extra dimension that we basically ignore. We add a third dimension, which has just a zero here. So, and everything is just zeros. And similarly, a matrix which is almost the identity matrix, except it has a component missing. and I'm going to call it f, like f after e. And since 0 is the same as minus 0 and so on, this relation still holds, right? If I square this, then here in the left, upper left, I get the minus identity matrix as I get here from these. And the plus 0 is just minus 0, so actually this relation is still holds. So I have sort of a kind of also a representation where I just ignore the third dimension. The interesting thing is that this f is not the identity matrix, and so you know it has even the determinant 0, right? If you compute the determinant of this 3 times 3 matrix, then this is 1 times 1 times 0, so that's 0. So this f3, unlike the identity matrix, is not actually invertible. And while I get this relation, and you know if I multiply with another power, with another I on both sides, then I also get this this relation, right? So if I take, for example, let's say, oops, sorry, this is also not correct. Second. Let's go with this. So if we take, d equals 1 here, right? If we take d equals 1 and compute this i3 to the power of 3, well, we get, for the second power, we get minus this matrix. And then since the first two entries of those are also just at the identity matrix, so it doesn't affect anything that you multiply with it, then the third power, i3 to the power of 3, will also be minus this i3 matrix, right? So this relation holds, which is also the relation that we had here, right? Except you cannot plug in d equals 0, right? It's not the case that i3 to the power of 2 would give the identity matrix, because a 1 cannot magically pop up here. So we have, while the two-dimensional case was really like exactly like the complex numbers, where if we square the I to 2, then we get the minus identity. Here, we don't have this relation, but every power that's higher than 2 still has the same property. You know, this is kind of funny. So we get this relation exactly as before. Except the case for d is 0 is not legal anymore, because we cannot get the identity matrix from this thing. Okay, this is what I want to point out. This is where the first difference arises. But nevertheless, we still have this breakdown of powers, and that will give us a lot of relations and eventually lead to various like Euler-like formulas that are even nicer, I would even argue. Okay, and so this was a special case. It will turn out that these matrices actually kind of correspond to the rotation around exactly one particular axis, set axis. Okay, but that's not so important. I can very straightly generalize this with basically a whole two-dimensional sphere, whole S2 of generalizations of that. So watch out now. There's some matrix calculations involved, but they are all like trivial calculations. We're going to define four functions, and you might know all of them. So first the norm of a vector, okay? Just we're in three dimensions here, so the norm of a vector x is just the sum of the squares of the components. Oopsala, square root of that, of course. So the norm is just the square root of the sum of the squares of the components. Then to go from a vector to the unit vector in the same direction. This I will call this n, and then the name of the vector. So given a vector, I can, that is not the zero vector, so I can invert the norm. I get this by dividing the vector by its norm, right? Then I get from some vector to a vector that has unit norm. Then, and here is the interesting thing, you know, in three dimensions, an anti-symmetric matrix, you know, matrix has nine components. If it's anti-symmetric, then the diagonal must be zero. And if also the upper right side, the components must be the same as minus the lower left side. Sorry. The anti-symmetric matrices in three dimensions have exactly three components. There's this, you know, there's actually this nice duality going on that also then pops up and is important in differential geometry, but it's not the topic of this video. And you know, similarly, if you're in four dimensions, then you can easily compute how many components an anti-symmetric matrix can have. So that would be, I think it's 10. And then, lastly, there is this tensor product where you just take two vectors and, I will call this X O times X it's this matrix where each entry is a multiplication of two of the components. And you can see here in the first, there's always just a vector, you know, x1, x2, x3, x1, x2, x3, x1, x2, x3. And similarly, the second component is also x1, x2, x3, and it's it's very, very easy to see and to compute. And you see, for example, the trace of the matrix, like x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared is exactly the norm squared and so on and so forth. So if you think of units, then this object is, this is still linear in X, and this is quadratic in X and so on and so forth, all these relations. Okay, we're going to make use of these four functions. What you can do easily is that if you take this matrix and also multiply it with itself, you know, you can imagine that if you multiply this thing with itself, then you get 0 times 0 plus minus x3 times x3 and so on and so forth. You multiply it, you suddenly see, oh, there's you square the anti-symmetric matrix, and it turns out you get a symmetric matrix out of it. So if you just do this calculation, you know, you take this matrix and square it, you get a symmetric matrix, and it's the following. It's minus, and then the norm squared times the unit matrix, this is the unit matrix in three dimensions, minus this matrix here. And you can also then check, you know, the quadratic nature that this object must have is also like present here, and so on and so forth. Okay. In particular, if you you know, we have seen that in this previous example where I defined one particular anti-symmetric matrix, and I squared it, and I get minus this matrix. And this is exactly what you get here if you plug in x equals 0, 0, 1. For example, you know, if you take this vector 0, 0, 1, then the matrix that you get here, you know, these components are 0, this component is 1. So exactly what we have there, and squared, the norm of this thing is 1. So it's minus the identity plus, and then this thing, if you look at it, everything is 0 actually here, except for the last one where we have the two free component. So this is a matrix which is everywhere 0 but here. And then if you subtract it from the unit matrix, then what's left is exactly the unit matrix minus this one component which has been set to 0. So we can easily convince ourselves this is really like, so it looks very correct. And again, you get here from the anti-symmetric matrix to the symmetric matrix. Okay. And finally, if you then take the third power, which is really just the second power times the thing again, then it turns out this is minus the thing itself times whatever is necessary to have this cubic linearity relation. And this is actually very easy to see that the third power is this thing, because here you have all these vectors directly, and if you multiply this thing with the anti-symmetric matrix, then this is really the same as taking the cross product of a vector with itself, so it must be zero. This is also why this notation is there, because this matrix is exactly, if you apply this matrix to any vector, then it's exactly the same as taking the cross product of x with that vector. Okay, and so that's why you can also, like, I mean, if you don't see, then you can do the computations by hand, but it might be instructive, but this is what you get. So in particular, we get this relation, generalizing exactly what we had before. If you take this, this is really a generic anti-symmetric matrix, and take it to the power, here's the power wrong again, sorry. And take it to the power of 2 plus any d, then we get the same object again times a multiplication factor. And so in particular, if we consider normalized vectors, so if we have vectors which have norm 1, so that this thing just doesn't pop up, then we get that the normalized vector to the power of 3 is minus, like the anti-symmetric matrix corresponding to the normalized vector to the power of 3 is minus this same matrix. And now, as a last kind of remark before I go to a more general case, let me point out that any minus sign is of course just an imaginary unit squared. It's just a way of representing it, right? So we have this relation here, any normalized vector, a generic matrix that is associated with a normalized three-dimensional vector, a generic anti-symmetric matrix, to the power of 3 is I to the power of 2 times itself. Okay? So this is what we're going to keep or have in mind. Now we're going to take a step back and actually generalize this relation. This is a generalized algebraic relation. It's the only thing that we're going to keep, and then we're going to look at power series. You might think of them as matrix power series or series expansions or formal power series, doesn't really matter. So the following is what we're going to consider. The matrix, or that, you know, it doesn't even have to be a matrix. I'm mostly thinking of matrices, and I'm even thinking of three-dimensional matrices in this case. But in general, we just take an algebra. By an algebra, I mean objects that you can add up and multiply, and to keep things simple, we think of them like multiplication among themselves and field elements, some field. You know, in the end, whatever you work with, you can check whether or not your properties hold for the kind of framework that you work with. And I don't make many assumptions here, so it might apply to many things where you don't even work with a proper field, and it's just some, you know, commutative, another smaller algebra, and some central algebra. These are all like cases that we might even go, but not in this video. But it's good to keep it in mind. Okay, so the object I'm going to work with is it's what I call J. It's some element, some special element of some algebra, let's say. And it has the following property. We have two natural numbers, P and B here. I call them P and B. Eventually they will denote like a number of partitions. And by B I mean base, but these are just, you know, associations. And they ought to have this relation. So if you multiply P number of J's with B number of J's, then they break down in the sense that the P ones become just this invertible field element. Okay, so while J might be a complex object, like in our examples, it will, for example, be 3 times 3 matrix, or maybe it is if something even more abstract or even more bigger or complicated. The rule is that once P of them are applied to B of them, then they break down and just simplify to mere invertible numbers, let's say. Okay, and this, of course, is a special case of this, for example. You know, the J might, for example, be this anti-symmetric matrix stemming from a normalized vector. P might be a 2 and B might be 1. Then so here it would say J to the power 3. And this small J might, for example, be the complex unit. And yeah, this is an example of this relation, right? The complex numbers themselves are another example. Or really just, you know, whenever J is element of the field, for example, if J is J, then this is also this is literally just identity. So we already have various cases where this applies. Okay. So let's say we have this JB here, right? I want to point out that if you let's say B is 5 and P is 3, right? So this relation would say J to the power of 8 equals small j to the power of 3 times J to the power of 5. One thing I want to point out is that, you know, if you have just J to the power of 6, so something that's smaller than the combined powers here, then you cannot simplify anything, right? Because the relation says exactly when you have at least B elements here and you have at least P elements here, only then you can do this kind of reduction. By reduction, I mean passing from the object capital J to the object small j. And so the lowest power that can be broken is P plus B minus 1, right? For example, it might be in the example I just gave 7, but as soon as you get to the powers P plus B, then you can break it down. I cannot write here, broken. So, okay, and one final note that I will make use of now in before deriving this generalized Euler formulas. Is the following. So I'm going to make use of a general partition of natural numbers into partitions, evenly sized partitions, and the formula for that, this projection here, is the following. We have two natural numbers P and I, where P runs from 0 to the number of partitions minus 1. So P is an index for the partition. And I just runs from 0 to infinity. And so it's if you stare at that for a second, then you can see that by running through pairs of natural numbers here, you get all the natural numbers here as well. So let me refresh. So for example, 0, 0, then everything is 0, it's just 0. If I start raising the first index, so if I raise that, well, then I get from 0 to p minus 1 at most, because the partition index only runs from 0 to p minus 1. But if I then raise the I index by 1, this is the second raise it by 1, then suddenly I have 1 p plus p, and so I get on with p, then p plus 1, and so on and so forth. And you can see that every number is covered here, right? For example, if p is 5, then this says 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on and so forth. So this is obviously this partition of the natural numbers. Okay, and therefore, if I have a completely generic series expansion, and the sum from, in this case, I will just start from B for the moment, you know, this, the base index. If this runs over all natural numbers starting with B, then I can make use of this partitioning, right? What I do here is a sum over all the partitions, okay? And here inside, basically, I have the sequence that goes along this axis, right? So this is the first partition. This is the second. Sorry, the other way around. So this is the. Yeah, exactly. These are the different partitions, and here the indices go on forever. So for example, here, this might be the I index, you know, going from 0 to infinity. This is the P index going from 0 to some certain like maximal partition. And I'm just splitting this infinite sum over all natural numbers, starting with B, into these partitions. I just split the sum into a two-dimensional sum, if you will, right? And what we have here, since I start with B, you know, the lowest index is j to the power of B, that means that in the inner sum, if I like take the capital J's here, they will be applied on the right hand side to at least B's, right? And so I can use this formula here for all elements in the inner partition. It might be necessary that you write it down yourself, but I exactly like rewrite this sum. I reshuffle it at least blockwise. And then of course you might now have to consider convergence criteria if you care for that. If there's not just a formal power series where you say I can do this reshuffling, and might have to think about it, but in the nice cases, for example, for this exponential function, for small numbers, this works out. This is why these things work. So a priori, this is just a form manipulation, but where it works, that it works, right? And so I'm using this to rewriting this. Okay, and so this is a rewriting, and as you might anticipate already, the Euler formula is also such a partition. You start with a particular series expansion. The coefficients are not so important, but in case of the exponential function, it's 1 over k factorial. And the partition is a partition of two blocks. And these blocks are individually the cosine and the sine coefficients, or cosine and sine terms that you sum up individually. And then you say, oh, this individual partition, you know, just the even numbers, just the even natural numbers and the corresponding terms, they sum also to a function which happens to be the sine function. The even numbers are the cosine function, and the odd numbers are the sine function. And so that's why the exponential function series is the same as these two series individually. So here also this partitioning happened, where every second has been like every second coefficient has been like pulled out and identified with the individual cosine function, and every even number has been singled out and identified with the sine function. And of course, you can also imagine that with seven partitions, right? So you take every seventh coefficient, and so you get then, if they all individually nicely converge, you get seven functions, and so you kind of partition one function, one series expansion, into seven series expansions. This is exactly what we did here. We just did it more generally. But okay, so this is just this aspect of it, like to kind of work out how the series expansion can be taken apart. But now we're going to already specialize to the two-dimensional case, because this is where nice names have been given to the to the functions, right? So there is, it just happens so that the sine and cosine also have this nice geometric interpretation of the lengths on the unit circle. So here we have actually given these things these nice names, and so that's why they are kind of practical and famous. So we're going to specialize here with that case as well. So what we're going to do here, for the moment, we're just going to set P to 2, but we leave the B a general for the second. Then what happens then is that the outer index is just a sum over 2, right? And then if, you know, I'm disregarding conversions questions, you always have this to check that on the individual basis, because it depends on the object J as well as on these coefficients. But here, what I already did is I flipped this thing around and evaluated these two and write it in this form. Okay, so the first index, P equals 0, corresponds to this object here, where you just have the even, like 2i plus b, and then you have this 2i plus b and plus 1, so this is the index p is 1. And so because I have two partitions, this thing splits into two objects. And also this j to the power of I times b becomes this kind of simple expression. And then specializing this more, looking at the case that we actually have with the rotations as well as with the complex numbers, we look at b equals 1, so we have this relation, j to the power of 3 equals some small j to the power of 2 times j. And what then happens is, what I do here is, you know, previously I just have just summed up for notation's sake at b, but now I can, you know, again consider the full series expansion, and I see that the first coefficient is a standalone object. This is going to be just a one times j to the power of 0, which in this series context we're going to interpret as a unit. And so we have this, okay. And then now, finally, after I have discussed, you know, the notion of partitions for general series, I'm going to consider the exponential function. Even though I love the exponential function, but in this case, you know, I don't even have a big attachment to the exponential function. But again, this is just a case where we have given these different partitions names, and so we can actually get some concise formulas here that are not just abstract series. If these are my coefficients, then the name for this left object is just the x of z, right? A0 is 1. And then here, we've just the even and uneven. We can identify the sine and cosine that I have previously, in the beginning of this video, defined, right? So it's then pretty clear that the sine, the hyperbolic sine and the hyperbolic cosine pop up here. And now you just, you know, if you're asking why, you know, divided by j and so on and so forth, then you also, just need to check what's the deal with these object in the general formula, right? I mean, you can see it in the sense that what is the sleekest way to get to that? Well, in the end, the easiest thing would be to plug in the terms here and compute the smallest coefficients and see what they have to be. So for example, the part that is linear in Z, you know, for A equals 1, is like k equals 1, so A1 is going to be the one where I is 0, so it's just A1. Then you have this the identity here, but this is then also multiplied with j to the power of 0, so this j are not there anymore. Then there's one j, this is going to be this j. But this uneven coefficients summed up give the hyperbolic sine of z times j. But then if you, like, we have just argued that in the smallest coefficients there is no j found, because this is j to the power of 2 times 0, so we have to cancel it out. And so here you see already, to make this work, this identification with the hyperbolic sign, I have to cancel out one j, and so you can see that this actually checks out. And the same can be done here, right, by subtracting minus 1 and dividing by j squared, you enforce that the smallest coefficient here is actually z squared, right? But because the hyperbolic cosine starts out as 1 plus z times j to the power of 2 plus something, and only if you actually do it like this at the starting point, you get the actually corresponding first coefficients as they have to be here. Yeah, and I like, from this video, if you ask my personal opinion, this is the nicest, this is the coolest formula in a way, because it's already pretty slick and compact. Nevertheless, we're going to break it down more to get it closer a little bit to Euler's formula, and then, so at the end we can kind of say that we have established Euler's formula also from various perspectives. But this is the kind of the strongest one, I would say. You have this very super simple relation, right? J to the power of 3 equals j, small j to the power of 2 times j. And just from that and like these formal manipulations, then where this thing converges, which is an analysis question, but where it converges, you have this relation. And you know, the important thing is to see how powerful it is, because well, here a priori you have to take this J matrix and have to take arbitrary high powers and take sums of these arbitrary high powers, and these J's, for example, they might be, I don't know, it might be like a 10 times 10 matrix. But due to this relation that this J matrices break down, this thing breaks down. And the fact that we have here more terms than in the Euler formula, right? In the Euler formula, we have just two expressions here. So this I is going to kind of correspond to the J, right? If you look at the formula, it says some number times capital J. And in the Euler formula, it says some number x times I. The I is kind of the like the j. This is the I is the object that has the algebraic relation I squares to minus 1. And so this is, there's some series expansion of x times j times the series expansion, another series expansion of x. And why do we have here more terms? Why do we have three terms? Why do we have this thing? Well, the reason is because this j squared doesn't break down. We don't have the rule that, for example, it squares to minus 1, but we just have this rule. Right? This rule is more like the weaker rule as we had it for the anti-symmetric 3 times 3 matrix. We don't have the nice, the super strong rule for like the imaginary unit, but we have a weaker version. And all the cases that we discussed so far are also weaker versions, right? You can see that even if you have, let's take P, as you said before, P, I think it was 3 and P is 5. Like you might find a matrix that is not actually like the imaginary unit and but has this relation. I didn't search for it, but on some powers this sure exists. And then you can even take these partitions of the infinite series. And of course, you will not find a nice formula because nobody has given these series expansions any name. Now, the only reason why the only reason why these formulas here are nice is because we write these four letters as a substitute for this strange kind of series. And it's understandable to the extent here that because we have this nice kind of geometric unit circle interpretation, so why not give it a name? And this might not be as easy or evident for other series expansions. Not many of the series expansions have names, although of course, you know, elliptic functions and so on, they also have their own name. But yeah, okay, and now we're going to break this down a little bit more. So this is the kind of formula for j to the power of 3 having a relation. And to make it look more like the Euler formula, let me, like here, this is a general set, right? So let's say this is actually an algebra over the complex numbers, some, I don't know, star algebra or something like that. And we rescale now, we multiply set by I over j. We have the actual complex I and the j that we have introduced. And then suddenly the formula reads like this. So if you have this I, then by the hyperbolic relations between hyperbolic cosine and cosine and so on, we can actually rewrite these hyperbolic functions as the normal, trigonometric functions. And so we get this. So it looks more like the Euler formula. The x of iz times, and this is a kind of, you know, a normalized thing. You know, if you interpret this relation here, for example, in the sense of an eigen, like if you view small j as a kind of eigenvalue of this thing, right? So for example, if j is a square matrix with just numbers of on the diagonal and they're all seven, all the same, like for example, you know, 10 times 10 square matrix that is diagonal and has a lot of sevens on the diagonal, this relation would also be true with small j being the number 7. And so in that sense, capital J divided by small j is kind of normalizing the j object. It kind of divides the eigenvalue out of it, if you want. And you get this thing, which is already extremely close to the Euler formula. The only thing that's really different is this kind of object. And let's consider the special case again, where when this j is that j, like this is what the special case, this is this case that I mentioned here. If these are just numbers, then this is just going to be 1 and e is also just 1. So then this would cancel out and we were left literally with the Euler formula. okay, but still a little bit more abstract at least. Let's say that j squares to minus 1. So for example, it acts like the imaginary unit. Maybe it's represented as something else, I don't care. But this relation, you know, this is really just in the case where j to the power of 3 simplifies, it's really just this relation. And I mentioned here that it is, for example, realized by just setting j to the imaginary unit. It's one way to forcing this. Then we get this relation out of it. Okay, also very close to Euler's formula, except for this term here. And then if we consider also that the capital J squares to minus 1, right? In all these places you can plug in for the capital and small j, you can plug in the imaginary unit or some representation of it, for example. Then you're left with this, and this is really also just Euler formula. But, you know, it's for all of these kind of matrices. Okay, so these were a bunch of formulas. This is really what I wanted to get at, this version here. And let's be a little bit more concrete and go to the Rodrigues formula, which is here now really just a special case where K is this anti-symmetric object that I discussed. So let's call, like take a general vector x again. Let's call small x the norm of it. I repeat what we had before. The square of the anti-symmetric matrix generated through this unit vector is this matrix, and then if you take higher powers, then symmetric and anti-symmetric alternate, and the sign also alternates every second time. And so this fulfills really this relation, right? And now if you plug in for J this anti-symmetric matrix and evaluate this thing, and collect the minus signs correctly, we get these kind of relations. You know, you can pick any, for example. This also works out. You know, we can exactly start here with this relation, for example. J is now our anti-symmetric matrix. We get that we have to add E and this thing. The E cancel out here. So the first term is just this projection operator, or this tensor operator, right? So this is a term in the three-dimensional case that still stays with us, you know, this symmetric term here, apart from the sine and cosine terms, this standalone term stays with us in the three-dimensional case. It didn't stay with us in the two-dimensional case because there this was actually just zero. In the two-dimensional case where J behaves like the imaginary unit. But now this stays. And the rest of the equation is literally just here plugging in the anti-symmetric matrix for J. And you know, and now you can play, you know, in reality the cosine term also has a constant term. The cosine starts with one, and only the rest of the terms of the cosine depend on x, right? So the first, if you just, for example, if you make a series expansion in terms of x, then the constant term will not be just this thing, but also one instance of this thing, because the cosine term also has a one in it. And then this and this will cancel. And what's left is then in the first, like zero order approximation and E, and then higher terms. And this is exactly the formula that is known as the Rodrigues formula, when the matrix version of it, right? So this is the exponential of the norm of the vector times this anti-symmetric matrix. This is the rotation matrix in the Lie group way. And then you get the sine and cosine terms. And in this notation, this is written down in terms of exactly the cross product matrix here. This is what's called K here. Whereas I have simplified it to this tensor. Maybe on this web page, I could imagine that they write it down otherwise as well. And you know, and if you actually apply this thing to a vector, then the cross product matrix applied to the vector becomes just a normal cross product. Here from this symmetric term, you get a scalar product, and the sine and cosine survive as they are. And that's why you can write down the Rodrigues formula of a vector without matrices, but just applying these vectors. And then you get the real Rodrigues formula that usually bears the name. This is this thing. And this is like, just take any vector. In this case, they call this V, and apply this matrix to it. And the nice thing is that, you know, this is a generic rotation matrix, has this sort of representation. And a generic rotation matrix, which has in principle 9 components, all the trigonometric aspects of it is really just these two series, right? These are literally just functions in one real dimension. And all the rest of the rotation matrix really is just some algebraic cross product and tensor product and, you know, scalar products and so on and so forth. Okay, and finally, one last step to getting back to the Euler formula is the following thing. You know, we're now in three dimensions, and we can think of, I have my coordinate system over there, a second. here's this the coordinate system that I had in this previous video, right? So this is three dimensions, and we might think of the complex plane as the xy plane, okay? So if the xy plane is the complex plane, then we have one extra dimension. Let's say we start with our vector x, and we orient the complex plane to be normal to the vector. The vector is normal on the complex plane, right? Just by definition, we imagine the imaginary unit like put into the three-dimensional, like cuts the three-dimensional space in half, and the axis stands out of it. Now, since as discussed in this video last week, that the axis angle defines the rotation. The rotation is one around the axis angle. That means that the turn that this Euler the motion that the Euler formula describes with the sines and cosines, you know, it can be thought of as this motion in this complex plane on the unit circle on the complex plane. So it can actually be described as a rotation around this x. And so if we have the situation that, you know, the blue vector is x, and let's say the yellow one is the imaginary direction. Now this is all the purely imaginary values. The orange one is the real one. Then clearly we have set up the system in a way that x is normal to both the imaginary axis and the real axis, and they're also in a 90 degree angle to it, their own to each other. And so we have the situation that our rotation x axis is normal to the real number line. You know, the real number line also lies somewhere there in this plane. And I didn't notice x is representing a real number line by r. And the statement that there is a right angle just means the scalar product is zero. And then, you know, we can take the cross product of x and r. We get a vector pointing in the direction. And, you know, I use vector, unit vector and axis kind of interchangeably here. It's all just a scalar, essentially. So we have some vector pointing in the direction of the imaginary unit. It will depend on whatever norm we have here or not, but whatever. And so therefore, if it now pass to the normalized ones, you know, now I'm taking whatever direction these three vectors tell me to go, and take the normalized vector, and I just apply the formula that I just have here, right? The x of the norm of x times the x like the Lie-algebra element, the anti-symmetric matrix, applied to one of the axes, then I can easily use this relation and this relation and together this formula that I have here and find that because of the inner product, this thing will be zero, this thing will be zero. I'm left with a cosine times an r, and this cross product will give me the unit vector in this direction, and so I have this here. And so you see here, suddenly, this is also really just Euler's formula of the complex plane embedded into a three-dimensional situation, right? This is really literally just the Euler formula. You can view it like that, where the imaginary where the imaginary unit which generates the rotation, you know, is conceptually separate though from the imaginary unit axis, like the imaginary axis, right? Okay, but nevertheless, this is like, since I've forced a lot of conditions, you know, this kind of autonormality relations, this is not extremely useful, this last thing, but this just how you can bridge these two worlds together. Okay, for my usual video length. This was more or less short. I hope that I can stick under 1.5 hours, and I managed that. I hope that was interesting. I really like this kind of expressions, and one has to find a balance between abstraction for the sake of it and being like getting the right intuitions. I would say a lot of the times, if you read more like advanced theoretical physics, like literature or so, then you might think, well, I could have maybe come up with that if I studied it, but I would never have thought that it would be worth looking actually into that. Or, and it probably is the case that a lot of these things are discovered and rediscovered because they don't seem useful at the time, but that's, I guess, just the process. Okay, have a good night.